faithful who are disoriented about the situation actual of the society. We can think that Bishop Lefebvre hesitate before takes the decision to open a seminary and to found the Society of St. Pius X. That was in the year 70, 45 years ago. If Bishop Lefebvre would have imitated almost all the bishops, the other bishops, because there were 250 bishops to fight in the council against the new religion, against the plot of the modernists and the liberals who wanted to change completely the church, make a revolution. But after the council, only two bishops had the courage to not to accept the council and its consequences. As you know, Bishop Castromayer, who had a very important diocese in Brazil, is a unique place in Brazil where there is petroleum, much oil. And there was 25 priests, many churches, many organizations with sisters for orphans, for old people, for hospitals, everything in that diocese. Unfortunately, when Bishop Castromayer died, his successor betrayed all this work and did an agreement with Rome, with Cardinal Castrillonoyos, Cardinal Ratzinger, and the result has been a total catastrophe for the diocese. And I knew too, for instance, I was in the same school, and we knew, for many years, the prior of the monastery of Flavigny, of Olivetains. And he was the first to have an agreement with Rome. And now there are many friars, many religious people. No? Now they are earning some money with the fabrications of little images and statues of Saint John Paul II. And in a campus, in the diocese, in their site, in internet, you can read litany to Pope Francis, who says, Francis, you who have said this, Francis, you have said that, you have done this, you have done that. That is the result. Who could have imagined that? I went twice or three times with Bishop Lefebvre to see Bishop Castromayer, and we visit his diocese and his priests. And they seem quite strong in the faith. And they have written very good leaflets and books to defend the tradition. But now, Everybody, not one single priest resist. They are all gone with the current. And Don Gérard, I knew him too, of Le Barou, a great monastery that he had asked his help to Bishop Lefebvre. And he went to the priories, and the faithful of the society helped him to build a big monastery, very beautiful, in stones. And after, in the moment of the consecrations, he abandoned the battle of the faith. And we can see, we shall see, that Bishop Lefebvre was very sad about that, and thought that it was a kind of treason, of abandon of the fight of the faith. And I knew too Father de Blinière, who with the Dominicans, he created a group of Dominicans, and he was received in Rome. And so I knew many of these priests who have done a deal with Rome. And for them, they received many guarantees, many promises, but Rome, the cardinals, forgot all these guarantees, all these promises. And most of them had to accept the new mass at least once a year in the Holy Week to concelebrate with the bishop of every place. And so, if Bishop Lefebvre and Bishop Castromayer would have said, well, we shall have too few people, who are we? We are alone. We shall have everybody against us, all the bishops, and we shall have the authorities in Rome. Everybody will be against us. We shall not be understood. So it's better to keep silence, to keep quiet. They had the edge of retirement. So God pushed them to do something. And what they could do better, as Bishop Lefebvre says, than to open a seminary and begin the formation of priests. And thanks to this formation, the society extends in all the world. So the tree was good. The fruits, the results were good. It is, of course, the work of Bishop Lefebvre who had the more extension in the world and who saved the biggest numbers of souls. And his influence has been very great in all the world. But the problem is, after him, the same that have occurred to Campos is occurring now in the society. And you know, everybody knows, that there are many signs and facts that show that an agreement with Rome is quite near, very near. We had first the recognition that the society is Catholic, is in the church, as they say, in the conciliar church, in Buenos Aires. If the society is Catholic in Buenos Aires, he's Catholic in Washington, in Paris, and in Rome, in all the world. And the proof is that Pope Francis supposedly gave a jurisdiction to all the priests of the society in the whole world. And this is already recognition canonical recognition of the society, because theoretically, for Rome, for some Romans, in the society we were, all of, the, of us, inclusive Bishop Ferré, we were suspense a divinis. They take off some effects, as says Cardinal Müller some months ago, some effects of the supposedly excommunication, but not about the suspense a divinis. And so if they pretend that we have jurisdiction to confess in all the world, so that means that they do not consider the priest as having censure by Rome. And so this is a recognition. We are already recognized. And you had these declarations of the speaker of the society, Régis Ducret, for instance, and in Paris, who had just some days ago, he gave two texts speaking about the ineluctable, unavoidable recognition, that we have no longer the choice. We cannot refuse. And after, he said a text, all the reasons for why the Pope Francis recognized the society. And so all the observadors in Rome, all the Vaticanists, and the papers, newspapers, Catholic newspapers in France and elsewhere, say that it's done. It's already done. But so we must remind what thought Bishop Lefebvre about this kind of recognition. For instance, I have here an interview by the newspaper man of Bishop Lefebvre on the 15th of June 1988. That means 1 month, more or less, after he signed for some hours the protocol, he retired immediately. And he retracted this protocol, project of agreement. And it was 15 days before the episcopal consecrations. So in this newspaper of Switzerland, friend of the society, we can see the Archbishop with Father Schmidberger in this conference. And he say, some people have a kind of sympathy for the tradition. They like the Mass, the Gregorian chant, like the Saint Peter, no? But in the same time, they affirm a submission unconditional to Rome. They want to obey, absolutely. And Bishop Lefebvre says, but we must absolutely know that today Rome is at the service of the revolution. And for this reason, awfully anti-traditionalist, against tradition. And so it was true in 88, and it is true today. We have seen the Pope Francis, who had destroyed religious order, like the Benedict, the Franciscans of the Immaculate. The seminaries of this order has been shut down, and the seminarians had to go to Rome, to the universities. Universities where you have boys and girls and mixed, no? And so, if they give what they want to give us, it is, like said Bishop Lefebvre, in the same opportunity, and it was told later by Father Schmidberger, Bishop Lefebvre says, we must thank the Blessed Virgin Mary because we have just escaped from a trap. If they offer that, it is a trap. Because every time they manage to have an agreement with any one of these 10 groups that signed an agreement, it was less strength for the tradition. It's of the tradition, every time. And now, one more is necessary to make enter into the trap, to destroy it, of course. First of all, to obtain of all the priests, the silence. Do not speak more about the Council, about the crisis of the Church, about the new religion, about the Council, no? And so, Bishop Lefebvre says, it is because they are anti-traditionalist, and because Rome is at the service of the revolution, that is why I refused to put me in their hands. What means to put me in their hands? To accept their authority, to tell to them, now I shall obey to you. I recognize I was wrong, and I shall now obey to you. That is why. To put us between their hands, in their authority. So, in Rome, they wanted only that recognizance my errors, I help them to go on with their revolution in the Church. It is very clear, very clear. All the priests, seminarists, there was more or less 10 priests who abandoned Bishop Lefebvre, abandoned the society to, I knew the superior of them, Father Bissick, he was in my class in Econ. He was a Swiss, and he is the founder of the Society of St. Peter. All those who abandon us, they do not realize this situation, the gravity of the situation in which we are. And they believe in the goodwill and in the good faith of the bishops and cardinals of Rome, of the Roman bishops and cardinals. Nothing is more false, says the archbishop. It is wrong, false. And this priest who abandoned us thinks that the cardinals in Rome will not have the possibility to take them in their revolution. But in fact, most of them have celebrated the new mass, at least sometimes, and they do not say absolutely nothing about the crisis. For the Society of St. Pius X, it would be the disappearance of her mission, because as we read in the sermon, Bishop Lefebvre create the society to resist to the destruction of the Church and of the faith. And so if we abandon this principle, the reason to be of our existence, the motive of existence of our society, our society is destroyed, disappeared. Bishop Lefebvre say it is exactly what will occur. They will be drawn. They will follow the current. And in the same interview, Bishop Lefebvre speak about Don Gérard, a big monastery that was friend of Bishop Lefebvre, and that went with Rome. They did an agreement. And so Bishop, the newspaper man asked to Bishop Lefebvre, how do you judge the propositions, the offers that Rome has done to Don Gérard, to this monastery? And Bishop Lefebvre says, for the cardinals in Rome, their objective, what they want, is to divide the tradition. When you have an enemy, you must divide him. And piece by piece, you will destroy him. That's what they have done. That was what is saying Bishop Lefebvre. They have deceived Don Augustin, this monastery of Flavigny, whose superior I knew when we were children in the school. They deceived Blinière, with his Dominicans. And now they deceived Don Gérard of the monastery of Le Barreau. And that makes our position every time more weak, weaken our position. And that is their aim, to divide, to make us disappear. We have to disappear. And that is what Cardinal Ratzinger always thought. For, as said Bishop Tissier de Malray, for Cardinal Ratzinger, always we were outside of the church, out of the church. We were in a schism. And so the objective of the Cardinal Ratzinger was to resolve, to end this schism. Unfortunately, in the society, Cardinal Ratzinger, Cardinal Castrillon-Hoyos convince Father Schmidberger and Bishop Feuillet that we are out of the church, that we are in an abnormal situation, and so that we must normalize our relations with Rome, we must get canonical recognition. We must reconciliate and to be reintegrated in the church, as they say. But which church? The conciliar church. That was an expression that Bishop Lefebvre repeat and repeat again. But Bishop Feuillet don't want to hear about that. No, he said, no, there is one church, the official, visible, as he say, visible church, and we have to be with him, to help them to fight for the tradition. But this is an illusion. This is an error. About the Council, there is a question of this Father de Blinière who was speaking. When he left the tradition, then he attacked Bishop Lefebvre, saying that Bishop Lefebvre had signed the text of the Council about the religious freedom. And it is true that it was possible to make this equivocation, because Bishop Tissier de Malraux, in his beautiful and very interesting biography of Bishop Lefebvre, says the same thing, that the bishop signed this text about religious liberty, Dignitatis Humanae, on religious liberty, and Gaudium et Spes. And so, the newspaper asked to Bishop. The journal, Sede Sapientiae, reproduced a document from the Vatican archives where there is your name written in your hand. What exactly is it, and what is this document? Archbishop Lefebvre, this idea of interpreting my signature as signifying approval of the conciliar documents germinated in the ill-intentioned mind of my adversaries. Approvals or refusals documents were obviously made for each particular document in the Council. But the vote about, for instance, religious liberty was put to vote. And the vote was secret, done on individual cards and made with a special pen that allowed the calculation of electronic votes. These are words of Bishop Lefebvre. The cards were taken in by the secretaries from the hand of each voter, from each bishop in the council. The larger sheets, after the larger sheets, which were passed around from hand to hand among the council fathers, and to which everyone added his signature, were nothing, had nothing to do with voting for or against, but signified our presence at this session for voting on these four documents. So it was a sheet of presence. I was present in this reunion of the Council, but the vote was secret. If you sign a vote, of course, and your neighbor will see, and then it is not secret. So it is very clear, Bishop Lefebvre did not accept these doctrines. And all his life had been a fight against these doctrines of the religious liberty, ecumenism, collegiality, and so on. All his life. All his book, many of these books speaks about that precisely. In on the occasion of the 20th anniversary of the founding of the Society of St. Pius X, Archbishop Lefebvre kindly answered the questions we asked him. And Bishop said, it is no longer just a question of mass, of the mass, as important that as it is, but that separates us from Rome is a matter of faith, of doctrine, of these doctrines, of the liberal doctrines, Masonic doctrines of the Council. And they say to, in that time, they said, why not to try one last approach to make a deal. And why do you think it is impossible? Answer of Archbishop Lefebvre. It is absolutely impossible in the current climate of Rome, which is becoming worse and worse. Today, it is worse. We must not delude ourselves. The principles which now guide the conciliar church, Rome, are more and more overtly contrary to Catholic doctrine. That was true 20 years ago, and it is true today. Of course, who cannot see that? And Bishop Lefebvre gives as example Cardinal Ratzinger, who says that the dogmas are not the last word on the matter, but are a kind of provisional disposition. For instance, the anti-modernist decisions of St. Pius X rendered a great service, but they are now outdated, say Cardinal Ratzinger. And Bishop Lefebvre says, et voilà, the position on modernism is turned around. These reflections are absolutely insane. Finally, says the Archbishop, the Pope is more ecumenist than ever. All the false ideas of the Council continue to develop, to be reaffirmed with ever greater clarity. They are, the people in Rome, the authorities, are hiding less and less. It is absolutely inconceivable that we can agree to work with such a hierarchy. Everything is said. And these sentences, there are dozens and dozens of them. And our friend, Father Piver, in France, he has now a big house for retreats. And the 8 seminarians of our new seminary in Avrier did their retreat of entry in this house of Father Piver. Well, Father Piver wrote a book, Our Relations with Rome, from the beginning, in the time of the Archbishop. And he showed all these dozens of warnings of Bishop Lefebvre. But Bishop Feuillet has prohibited these books in the chapels of the society. And Father Piver sent it to all the priests, for instance, in Switzerland. They had the order to send back all these books to him. Because we must not read what said Bishop Lefebvre. So now they have a new site in the society, Marcel Lefebvre. But they give an incomplete image of Bishop Lefebvre. Like in the movie, they show the great missionary, the great man of church, but they are very discreet about his fight against the new religions, against the Council. Against. And so now we shall abandon the fight of the faith, as say Bishop Lefebvre, speaking of Don Gérard. And so what must we do? I had worked for 8 years in Mexico, and I went to go to see my father in Argentina in 68. And I follow a retreat of Saint Ignatius in Argentina. And the priest, 2 French priests, sent me to see the Archbishop, because I told them I thought I had the vocation in 68. And speaking, with this Archbishop, Monsignor Tortolo of Paraná, who had been the head of the Episcopal Conference of Argentina. He told me, well, you are French. In the council, I have met, I had a good friend, a French bishop, Bishop Lefebvre. And so that is the first time I heard about Bishop Lefebvre. And so later, I went to France. I saw an old priest I knew in Paris. And I went to Switzerland to look for Bishop Lefebvre. And I found him. And so in 72, I entered with 35 seminarians in the second important years of Econ. Important for the number. And in 77, it was the second ordination of this priest. I was the same year of I entered with Father Schmidberger and with Bishop Williamson. But Father Schmidberger was ordered very soon. He was only 3 years in Econ because he has done already his philosophy. The problem is that he has done this philosophy in a German university, with a German philosophy. Kant and all these modern philosophers. And so we are in this situation. So what to do? Well, we are not young, but Bishop Lefebvre was not young when he began his work. We do not pretend to compare us to Bishop Lefebvre, of course. But we are in some way in the same situation. What shall we do? Nothing. If we do nothing, maybe there will no more fight for tradition. Or very few, like the Saint Peter. And because it is, we see that the Society of Saint Pius X is becoming another Society of Saint Peter. And in our schools in France, we receive many young people from the families of the Saint Peter. And the school, the level of the school, is down, is sinking like the boat. For instance, this year in the seminary of the society, there was 4 Frenchmen only. And maybe one only of them is coming from the school of the society. In our seminary, we open nearby the Dominicans of Avery, we have 3 Frenchmen who come from good families. And of course, if they are chosen to come with us, with Dominicans, because they know that we are in positions in conformity with the ideas of Bishop Lefebvre. It was not the ideas of Bishop Lefebvre. It was ideas of all the popes since the French Revolution who have fought against the ideas, Masonic ideas, of the French Revolution. And you have all the encyclicals that are explained by Bishop Williamson of Pius IX, Saint Pius X, and that was. This is the fight of the popes. And it was exactly the fight of Bishop Lefebvre. He had nothing original, nothing personal. But unfortunately, most of the seminarians and most of the professors in Econ did not understand the fight of Bishop Lefebvre. And so you have the first director of Econ, Father Masson. He was not a Mason, but his name was Masson. And he had a site after. because he was received in the Vatican by John Paul II, and he was done Monseigneur, not bishop, but Monseigneur, Masson, and you have his history in internet, no? Well, Bishop Father Masson went out of the seminary after 1 year, when I was in the seminary, because he did not understand. And after we had another good director, very good person, who knows very well the theology, moral theology, was our professor, a very good man. But he did not understand Bishop Lefebvre. Bishop Lefebvre told me when we were in Argentina in 77, they are waiting for me. And who was waiting for Bishop Lefebvre? The director and the professors, all the professional corps of ECOD. And when he came back, that was in July, it was just after the benediction of the Church of Dickinson. I was with him, and after we went to Chile and Chile and Argentina. And when he came back from this trip in Swiss, he had all the professors and the director, Chanoine Berthaud, who told him, Monseigneur, you have to let us the responsibility of the seminary, because there are some things that must be corrected. And if not, we shall be obliged to renounce. And Bishop Lefebvre told them that they were free. If they want to go, the door was open. And they went. And they were replaced by the priest who received their formation by Bishop Lefebvre, in Econ. And you had Bishop Tissier, Bishop Williamson, Father Oulagnier, all these young priests. But of course, all these directors and priests and professors in Econ had their friends, seminarians. These seminarians were Father Schmidberger, later other friends of the Father Pfluger, Feulet, all this. And all these seminarians did not understand profoundly their not the convictions of Bishop Lefebvre. And that is why when Bishop Lefebvre died, they went to Rome and they forgot everything. And they saw, no, but this Pope, these cardinals are nice, they receive us very well, they smile, and they are the visible authority. And they gave them a complex of culpability, that they were not in the church. They had a beautiful institution, and it would be a pity that this beautiful institution, work of Bishop Lefebvre, would end in a schism. And so to avoid that, they had to take back with them the society in Rome. But Rome, we must not forget now, Bishop Feulet speaks many times of the declaration of Bishop Lefebvre, but he do not say all the declaration. And this declaration was called in 21st of November of 1974, is called the Declaration of the Two Romes. And now if you see the presentation of the seminary of Winona, of the society, you see only the first part of the declaration, one Rome. We have always followed the eternal Rome, mistress of truth, light of the world. But the second part is the other Rome. But we have always refused to follow the modernist and liberal Rome that was declared in the Council Vatican II and in the Reform who followed and who comes from the Council. This part disappeared. And so here we are. So, but we see that in so many groups, there is one group who is faithful to Bishop Lefebvre, and he is the Dominicans of Avrillé. 11 priests and maybe 10 brothers, friars, that are exactly in the position of Bishop Lefebvre. And so we decide with them to open a seminary. We began on the 3rd of October, and we found a beautiful house and the friends who pay the rent. And so we have a seminary with 8 seminarians. And we have already 5 or 6 vocations for next year. And I saw 2 days ago a young boy, North American, to tell me that he wants to go and to enter in this seminary. So we our friends in France are looking a big house of 30 or 40 rooms for next year. And we have already seminarians who has been 4 years in the seminary of the society in Germany, in Salzkofen. And of course, these seminarians could be ordained within 1 year. And if Bishop Lefebvre, as it is evident, receive in a short time his personal prelature, it is evident that some priests in France and some seminarians maybe will come with us. And so, of course, we could ordain some priests in 1, 2, 3 years. And it is very important because I saw in Philippines, Australia, and Father Chazal and Father Pico, and now Father Sunil, I could ordain in India, no? But there are many, many groups who have no priest and who say they cannot, in conscience, they cannot go on with the chapel where they were going. And it is the case here in the United States, where Father Sandy Haas is working quite a lot. And as in France, we have a big house for retreats. Father Sandy Haas is to dispose many, many retreats in Richfield. And many people, hundreds of persons, know him in the States. And so, but he has with him, well, some 4 days ago, we had a supper, and we were 6 priests. And near New Orleans. And there are, so there is hope. What can we do? Very little. But of course, we are not Bishop Lefebvre. But Bishop Lefebvre, in the principle, in the beginning, had very few priests with him. And many priests did not understand really his fight. No? But we must do our duty. And it is because we are doing our duty that we are in a normal situation. One day, Father Schwitberger, and he told that to all the priests of the society, mainly in France, told me personally, in his room in Argentina, and we received him in the seminary in Argentina. He told me, "But Father, won't you agree with me that in the society, in the church, we are not in a normal situation?" And that is a proof that he don't understand really what is the problem, doctrinal problem, of Bishop Lefebvre, of the society. As I told sometimes, as a joke, no? It could be if you, when the Titanic sank, you had some people who had the luck to be in a little boat to survive. And so if a newspaper man like Father Schmidberger wants and asks to the ladies, but lady, madame, you are alone in this little boat in the middle of the night and of the ocean, don't you think you are in an abnormal situation? You should go back to the Titanic. It is like that, exactly. Of course, if the situation of the church would be normal, then we would be in an abnormal situation, evidently. But as are the things, when you have now Pope Francis, who says, "For me, a Catholic God does not exist. I do not believe in a Catholic God. For me, well, God is for all the religions, all the world." Or many other things. For instance, now, ultimately, on the 8th of September, he is accepting something like a Catholic divorce, more or less, no? The marriage has no strength. It's very easy as you write a letter to the post office and they will recognize that the matrimony was void. So in this terrible situation, we have to be, to remain faithful to our duty, and we shall defend the faith as we have learned with Bishop Lefebvre. In our seminary, where Bishop Williamson is in this moment, no, and give conferences and courses to the seminarians, all the evenings during the supper, we listen for half the supper recordings of Bishop Lefebvre. And so I think it's very important to read and to listen of all what Bishop Lefebvre was saying. We just want to follow exactly his positions. We think that the two bishops were sent by the Providence to help us in this fight. And so we must follow the path they have thought about this situation, about the Pope, about the Mass, about all that, for 20 years or more. And so, and they were good theologians, very good theologians. Many people recognize that of their time. And so the decisions, the pastoral decisions and the practical conclusions they had, we must follow. And so, if you have some questions, I shall try to answer.
When will it end?
Yes, we have always to begin. It's like these Russian puppets. You have a big one, then a little one, and more little. But, well, we do not know the future. Only God knows the future. But we must fight till the end. You have this novel, The Last of the Mohicans, There is another one, The Last of Samurais. Well, we must say, if God helps us, we shall be in the last of the Catholics. And God told us, when I shall come back, there will be very few people who will have kept the faith. The faith will have disappeared. And in Quito, you had this revelation of the Blessed Virgin Mary in the 70th century. She said, in the 20th century, the faith will disappear. It is clear. And she spoke about a bishop who will fight and will maintain what may be maintained. It's difficult not to think about Bishop Lefebvre when you read that.
What do we think about the Year of Mercy? How should we think about it? How should we, the Year of Mercy that...
The Dominican of Avrier have spoken about this question in the same way of Saint Thomas. First, the objections, why maybe we should accept, but we cannot accept, and after the answers to the objections. In a recent text, you can find it in the internet, easily.
On the Year of Mercy, is it true that he just gave the society the authority to hear confession, but not authority to say the Mass?
We are in the Year of Mercy, we are in good company with homosexuals, transsexuals, all the public sinners. So he could not let us out of this mercy.
Bishop Tissier, and is he willing to communicate with you and Bishop Williamson?
Bishop Tissier said a sermon on the 1st of January of this year. He said, we shall not compromise. We shall not have an agreement. Be sure we shall stay in the fight of the faith. Well, very well. But the facts are showing the contrary. And he said, our false friend says that we have been too long separated from Rome and we shall end in a schism. And our false friend said this, that. The problem is he must not be well informed. Because who has told that? Father Pfluger, who is number two in the society. But I think he must suffer quite a lot, and we must pray for him. It is said that he has not a good health, a problem with the stomach. No? But he must be very strong, I think, and very worried. He must worry about this situation. And. I can hope that he will not accept a compromise, a real compromise, one compromise more. Because the first compromise with Rome was the expulsion of the Bishop Williamson. And this compromise was signed. And some more, no? Some others.
How to contact you, and is it possible for people to send you letters?
Of course, I have internet, no? And or by the Dominicans. We all every day we have the meal with the Dominicans, and all the seminarians too. So this is a very good example for the seminarians to see the humility, the obedience, the prayer of the Dominicans.
Are you the rector of the seminary?
Yes. Yes. As, yes. Yes.
Are we to understand that Bishop Williamson is part of the formation of the seminarians at your seminary?
No. As I had to come for 10 or 15 days in the United States and Mexico, I asked to Bishop Williamson if he could come for some days to know the seminarian, the seminary, and give some conference to the seminaries. Yes.
First, thank you for coming here at TC. Will, when you ordain priests, will you be doing, will they be starting missions, or will they be staying at first?
Well, Bishop Lefebvre, 10 days after my ordination, I was with him in the consecration of the Church of Dickinson. And after, I was with him when he was in Chile and Argentina. And then he left me in Argentina and told me, well, you must begin to.
Since the reason for not making an agreement with Rome is so that they won't convert us, it looks to a lot of people as if there's no danger for the moment. But wouldn't you say that even without making a formal agreement signed by both parties, that we are already starting to be converted by them?
It is normal that if we are in tractations with them, in this particular Bishop Ferry says, we thanks, we have gratitude, we manifest our gratitude to the Holy Father for this paternal goodwill and so on and so. And so when you speak like that, it is difficult to criticize. Well, it's a very difficult question because many times it depends on the priest with whom you speak. And I think that that's once the meaning, no, of what is as told ultimately Bishop Williamson. It is not, of course, it is not for us to go back precisely. That is what we do not want to do, to go back to the new church, new religion, new mass, and so on. But on the other hand, sometimes we can say, but God has forsaken, abandoned all the Catholics. Because 99% of the Catholics, 98% of the Catholics in the world have never heard about Bishop Lefebvre or tradition. And we can think that many of them know some priests that probably have, well, in any case, can give some valid sacraments. as the sacrament of penance, the confession. And that we can think that these people may receive by this sacrament of penance the grace of God. That is what means Bishop Williamson. We must not. We must avoid a radicalization. No? It's always a danger for us, no? And of course, now we see in the United States that many people who were in the society are going now with a celibacantist priest. Why? Because they lose the confidence in the society. And so you have many people who go, as say the scriptures, the pastor, the shepherd will be struck and the sheep will go anywhere. So they see a priest on this direction, they see a priest on the other direction. It is a confusion. And but who is responsible of this situation? Is the people, the men in Menzingen who said, no, now the situation has changed. The situation in Rome is much better. We have friends in Rome. And we must normalize. So, of course, many people, and you see all this situation in the school and so on, there is disorientation, trouble, and so, it is a pity.
In one of the points that some chapter in the professional and I'm on the saying the sins are forgiven, are sins forgiven?
Well, if they say the words of the valid absolution, yes, there is absolution, yes, valid. I have just answered in some way about this, what means the meaning of this last declaration of Bishop Williamson. But I think we must read them carefully and understand exactly what he's saying. And he precisely, he does not say this. He did not say, we shall go back to the new order. No. No. He had, if he has problems with Bishop Foley for 3 or 4 years, it's because of that. Because Bishop Foley wants an approximation with the new religion, the new Rome, and because Bishop Williamson every week is giving us very good arguments not to follow Bishop Foley in that direction. So, of course, that is not the meaning of this declaration of Bishop Williamson. You must, I think we must read carefully and see the argumentation, the arguments of Bishop Williamson. I know him, I have known him since 72. And I can tell you, I went to see him in England some time ago, to speak about some of these things, these situations, and I can say you, I trust him. He has not fallen on the banana.
Do you have any reason for concern that he is now allowing Father Stephen Abraham to serve the faithful in England, given Father Abraham's past?
Well, church has laws for this kind of very sad and horrible situations. There are laws. And Father Peter, who has been many years the canonical advisor of the society has taken a full knowing of this situation, the circumstances, exactly the situation, exactly as it was. And he applies to this situation the laws of the church. And he thinks that with the precautions, necessary precautions, if there is, of course, you must have none danger, you must not put any one, only soul in danger. If you, if these precautions are taken, then you may try to save the soul of this priest. Because in the society we have, unfortunately, had many, many situations, difficult. And some priests have gone, others no. And so, of course, you must try to help this priest not to lose their soul. Of course, without putting one only soul in danger, you must be sure that there is no danger for no other. And so you must control exactly the kind of apostolate that he can make. For instance, Father Abraham was maintained by Bishop Feuillet and Father Morgan in England, the superior of the district of England, and he was in Highclere, in Wimbledon. Well, he has been years in this house. And so, on the other hand, so you have to try to save these souls, and on the other hand, it is clear that Bishop Williamson would be alone in his house, and it would be a little difficult for him because he's giving every month maybe 12 conferences in 12 groups in France to many people. No? And he could difficultly do this work, preparation, etc., if he would be absolutely alone in his house in Broadstairs.
Do you mind me asking, is it true that he is, Father Abraham is actually out serving the faithful, having masses with parishioners? Is that true?
What I knew when I went there is that he was going one morning on the Sunday. He was going to the chapel of London where there is 15 faithful. All these faithful are aware of this situation, and he say mass, and he go back immediately to the priory in Broadstairs. We can, of course, this is a very difficult situation, very problematic, but other times, I say you that the church has his laws for this kind of situations. And in this situation, you cannot say it's all the same thing. There is some things are more grave than other. In this kind of sins, you have many degrees, no? Of course, it is very painful and very difficult, no? But other time, we must do what the Church asks us to do in these circumstances. In this case, you have canon, you have laws, it is contemplated in the canon law, and so with the prudence, the necessary prudence, of course, that you have to be in that. But as I tell you, Bishop Ferré and Father Morgan and all the priests knew this situation, and Father Abraham was in the house of the district in England for years. For years. Of course, it is understandable that for many people would think, no, it's better to forget it, and it's a problem. It's a terrible problem. That's why we must be very, very careful when we accept a candidate to the seminary.
One more question on the subject, and I apologize, but I just want to be very clear where you stand.
Yes, yes.
Are you telling me that there is a canon law that allows a priest that has two accusations against him, one with a minor, to go out and serve the faithful again?
Yes,
that is allowed in the church?
But what you must know is what is exactly the accusation. What is exactly? Yes.
Excellency, he's admitted that he's had a problem, according to somebody on the internet, and he's also tempted, and he ought to be taken out of circulation and get some psychiatric help or something.
But about this point, I have been told, no, that it is not exactly as you said, because you must go back and read carefully what it is said, what he said himself, and this is very delicate problems. If you change any fact, you can change all the case, all the case. And well, this is a very painful situation, but I think that the precautions has been taken in Highclere, in the house of the district of England, for years, and these precautions are taken today to avoid any danger. Well, that's all I can say.
Your Excellency, it seems to me, you know, you read all this on the internet, and I have yet to read one person out of the hundreds that are Catholic, because if you're a Catholic, you know, if I killed my wife last night, and I come to you for confession, and I say I killed my wife, and you say, okay, 4,000 rosaries, I'm clean, right? Yes, no, yeah, I'm okay, right? So how can some other one turn around and accuse me of killing my, and hold it against me? Now, the civil law is different. We're not talking about
yes.
civil law. We're
now,
talking about church law.
What
and
is...
so if he's a priest, and he went to confession, he should. Who are we that we should turn around and hold it against him? That's my point. I mean, it just seems very un-Catholic that 99.9% of the internet
is against him. The point is that nobody must be in danger, put in danger by such a person.
Sure.
And so you must be absolutely sure that all the precautions are taken to avoid any danger
right.
so of another temptation.
Right, and the society has not assigned him the job to go out to a boys' camp and be the only one there with 10 kids. So they're doing what they can, and if, you know,
if there is any danger, as I told you, anybody could be in danger about this situation, it must be avoided. I think that is what the church has done before our crisis, because this case, unfortunately, were very rare, but have existed in the church before the council, before. And so the church had to take some precautions. I had heard about cases like that. It could be said in some schools in any country of the world. You had some cases where priests had an attitude, it was not worse you can imagine, but that was not normal. And so, well, the church has to deal with this situation. But before it was more easy. You could send them as omoni, capellan,
chaplain
of sisters. I don't know.
Do you know, does Bishop Tisseray, there have been people try to meet him in Chicago to go there and not been successful. Does he talk with you or Bishop Williamson?
Well, on the phone? one could think that the fact of Bishop Tissier in Chicago is quite far from the other French priest. And it is a pity because he could give them good advices, and he is almost exiled there. I don't know her, and
she was complaining to Father Chimpano and to Bishop Winston that you didn't believe in her and that you asked her for a sign. I saw the email.
I'm not sure of that. I think if you write a good letter, short letter, good letter, well, respectful, to Bishop Williamson, I think he will answer to you.
You can call him on the phone, 6 hours.
You can call. Do you believe in her?
Yep.
Do you believe in her vision?
Ah. Nobody is obliged to believe in a private revelation. But the person who is object of these revelations, if her conscience tells her that it is something true, like John of Arc, she is obliged in conscience to believe in it. But of course, she must take the counsel of a priest, of her directors, to know if she can accept that. As it was the case in Lourdes, in La Salette, in Fatima, everywhere. No? The priest tells, but if the priest says, there is nothing against the faith, for instance, then the person may be obliged in conscience to believe in their revelation. But nobody else. What I can say is that Bishop Urien says that with millions of rosaries, he got his lifting of excommunication. But what we can say is that an ambassador of France in Rome, so of course he knew Cardinal Ratzinger, in 1994 wrote a letter in which he gave a plan to get a reconciliation between the society and Rome. And he says, in that case, we do not let that to the theologians. We shall resolve that by diplomacy. And I, as a diplomat, I can say that. Well, Rome could do two steps to create a climate of confidence. One, to permission for the mass. And second, to take lift the excommunications. And of course, the society would have to make a step too. For instance, about the Council, traditional interpretation of the Council. Well, that was written in 1994. And 2 years after, I think his wife, go on with the ecclesiastic in Paris and with the society to make the Greek. That was secret. I was not aware about the Greek, no? And they discussed, and after a priest who was in that, responsible, Father Leland, says, write a book about that, saying for a necessary reconciliation. And after many years, you had the motu proprio with the authorization, more or less, for the mass and the lifting of the excommunications with millions and millions of rosaries. Well, that's all what I can say. With the crusade of rosaries. But of what I have read, this idea of the crusade of rosaries came from this person, Mrs. Anderson. But the decision for the million of rosary and the thankful to the Blessed Virgin Mary in Lourdes for these millions of rosaries, and he thanks the Blessed Virgin Mary for the lifting of the excommunications. That's a fact.
On the lifting of the excommunication, They specifically said the four bishops, but no mention was made that I know of Bishop Castro de Meyer or Archbishop Lefebvre. So are they still, quote, excommunicated, or?
They had an explanation soon ago, a few days ago, about these things from the society, saying that if we consider this and that, we could consider the excommunications of Bishop Lefebvre has been lifted.
Yeah, so it's opinion. I mean, it's not from Rome.
No.
So there must have been a reason why that Rome only picked the four bishops and not the others.
Of course.
What could that be?
Wasn't the lifting of the excommunications, that was a lie to begin with, and it's a blasphemous to give Our Lady credit for something that's a lie. Because they were never excommunicated. That's the
of
position
course,
of the society.
Of course.
They were never excommunicated.
Of course. For us, nothing. No? Mm-hmm.
Hit heads with each other as far as the Vatican II Council, pastoral,
the young priest have not the same convictions. It is clear. Bishop Furet says, what is new in the society in one of his letters? Well, the priests are aging, generations pass. And so we have now the young generation, no? The young priests. And they have not the same convictions. And Bishop Philippe put them in a post of responsibility, everyone, no? As a prior, as a director of seminary in Australia, and so on.
I heard that there were four fires in France that left one of them to an Ecclesia Day. And three of them to the Novus Ordo, in that they were actually at one time strong priests.
Yes.
I think a lot of priests, I think a lot of people really do not understand Archbishop of them. I really do not understand the fight, what you said before. Did you know these men?
Well, we know that there are six priests of the society, ex-priests of the society, that are in the diocese of Toulon. In the south, on the sea, on the Mediterranean. And one, Father de la Motte, went to the diocese of Versailles. And we have many cases like that. But of course, if you convince the priest that they are in an abnormal situation, they will normalize their situation.
Quería preguntarle, yo le voy a hablar en español, porque todo lo que se dice, diríamos, son presunciones, ¿no?
¿Es?
Son presunciones, pero en concreto.
No, son, son facts.
Exacto, pero quería preguntarle, ¿ha tenido una orden directa, diríamos, del Monseñor Felé, que haga algo distinto a lo que justamente se venía a hacer como orden? A lo que no quería hacer con el señor Lefebvre, porque todo podríamos decir, yo me pongo en la postura, diríamos, del otro lado. Dice, sí, son peleas personales, algo, la escuela va mal, todo, uno ve el cambio, pero así en concreto, ¿han dicho desde arriba, ven diferente, hagan algo distinto?
One thing concrete is the expulsion of Bishop Williamson. And there are another things. There are the doctrinal declarations of Bishop Ferry of the 15th of May of 2012. And other things. Ultimately, there is ex-seminarians of the society, Shane Johnson, who wrote 15 facts. They are facts. And on the side of Rome, they are facts. When Bishop Feuillet says he has been nominated 10 years ago as judge by Rome, of course, with the new canon law, this is a fact. When you have this recognition in Argentina and now in the world, these are facts.